First, I would like to talk about Octolinker. Octolinker is a browser extension that brings code navigation to GitHub. And without further ado, I want to jump into a live demo so you get a sense what Octolinker does. Here you see the GitHub page of Express.js, and there is a package.json file, and Octolinker makes imports, or not imports, sorry, dependencies here clickable. And also it, you can hover over those and you get a call out with the name of the of this project, description, stars, and so on. And let's scroll down to Mocha. So if we click here, we will jump straight to the Mocha GitHub repository. And so this is really awesome for discovering new dependencies. And this is the original use case why I wrote Octolinker in the first place. When I wrote the first version, I was new to the Node.js ecosystem and I was quite overwhelmed with the amount of dependencies. And whenever I served up a package.json, I was curious what all those dependencies do. And so that's the reason why I created Octolinker. But it also can do much more. So if you are in a source file, like in this index.js, you get also code navigation for this require statement, and it will bring you to this import basically of this file. And from here, you can also, you get also the call out, and you can follow as from the package.json to this repo. It also works for native modules from Node.js, like the path. So if you click here, you will land on the Node.js documentation. And it also works in PRs, which is quite nice. So for example, if there is a new file added or a new dependency, you can just hover over or follow it. And it also works with relative files. So in this case, we will jump to the utils file in the given context of the PR, which is maybe sometimes useful if you want to get more context. Yeah, that's Octolinker. Wait a second. Just need to organize my windows again. So the initial version, as I said, I wrote 7 years ago. It was quite simple. It relied heavily on the DOM structure and class names provided by GitHub. And I built it mainly for myself, as mentioned. It had support for NPM and Bower only, because that's the only thing I was interested in back then. This was working fine for 307 days. And then, surprise, GitHub changed their DOM structure. Luckily, it was an easy fix, so I only had to update a few class names. And then it was working again for another 144 days. It happened again. I made again the easy fix, but then I decided to do something about it because I was really annoyed of not controlling the DOM or So I wanted to decouple Octolinker as much as possible from the DOM, from GitHub itself, so I don't rely on them. Today, Octolinker supports over 20 languages and tools. It's used by over 30,000 active users. The Octolinker API is deployed in 5 regions and almost serves 1 million requests a month. And since a few months, it's available in all major browsers. Before I can talk about how I test Octolinker, I need to briefly explain how Octolinker works. So there's this, as I mentioned, this idea of decoupling Octolinker from the actual DOM. So there's a file reader which turns the HTML into a JSON structure. So every line in a file is becoming a JSON object. And here you see one brief example. So with a few properties, file name, path, type, and so on. And testing this is fairly straightforward. It loads, in the test, we load a fixture file, and then we do simple asserts on this file after calling the file reader. Here we use just snapshots. In case you are not familiar, it's like a Git diff. So in case the number changed from 3 to 19 for whatever reason, you have to then recreate this snapshot, which is super useful in such contexts, because otherwise you have to write a lot of expect to cover all the things you want to cover. And the interesting part is that the fixtures are updated before we run tests. So there's this update fixtures shell script, which is basically curling a few GitHub URLs and is writing the HTML response to disk. So we always run on the latest version of the GitHub DOM. For historical reason, a version is also stored in Git. So in case something is totally off, there is a way to compare the two versions. But I only needed it once, luckily, because it's also quite complicated because there are a lot of changes happening on GitHub every day. The next thing is, as said, Octolinker supports quite a few plugins or languages. And so there's this idea of plugins. And a plugin has a few core ideas. And one of them is that we use regular expressions to find import statements or require statements in the source code. So rather than building an AST abstract syntax tree, we use regular expression because this is way more simpler and also easier to adapt to other languages. So this is how a test looks like for such regular expression tests. Here you see just an object with two properties, valid and invalid. And then each element in this array is made of two elements again. So the input and the expected output. So that way you don't have to write the boilerplate code yourself all the time. So at runtime, so to say, the test is working through this JSON object and generating the tests for you. So it's super easy to add different test cases just by adding the cases to the valid or invalid property. And that's the reason why we have over 460 tests just with for regular expressions. The next step is, once we get the module name, we need to resolve this to a UL. So there's this idea of resolvers. And a resolver is called with a file path, which is currently the current file, and the actually module name. Testing this is, again, quite simple. So you just call the resolver function with the two arguments, and then you check the expected outcome. And then at the end, we need to insert the link into the GitHub DOM. And this is the most complicated part in Octolinker. It sounds simple, but a text match can span across different childrens. So this needs to be rock solid. And therefore, we have also quite a few tests in this area. And again, we're using tests and just snapshots to ensure this is correct. And here you see the helper function, which is basically helping you to construct the test, where you only have to provide an HTML string and a regular expression. And then at the end, we get the link insert into the DOM. There's only one tiny bit that I left out, which is if a module is actually an external dependency, like a package from NPM, then we need to reach out to the Octolinker API, because in the early version of Octolinker, there was a huge mapping list of module name to GitHub repository. And this was working back then where it was 200,000 modules. But since it's millions of packages, this is not suitable anymore. And also with the increasing support for other languages. So now this is the reason why there is this Octolinker API. So the Octolinker API accepts a registry type and a module name, the target it's called here. And then it's basically just a proxy to public registries like NPM Compose or RubyGem with a caching layer. And then it does a few things to figure out the actual GitHub URL. Most likely it's somewhere in the package JSON of the package itself. It's the homepage field or the repository source field, something like that. And then it gets returned to the client, to the browser extension. Testing here again is done via a helper function. So you have this helper function that accepts three arguments, which is the registry type, the module name, and the expected return value from the API. On CI, a server is spawned, and then it performs all the requests against this local server. But it because it's just a cloud function or Lambda function, it's basically a production-like environment. Just the caching stuff is missing here. And end-to-end testing. The main goal for end-to-end test in Octolinker was to make it super easy for people and also me to contribute new tests. And this is also handy when it comes to maintenance. Octolinker uses Puppeteer, which is the Node.js API that allows you to control the browser. So we spawn a Puppeteer instance, and then we load in their Octolinker. And then we can just, like a user would do, navigate to certain URLs and do a few things. So how to make this simple? The idea is that in order to write an end-to-end test, you don't write an end-to-end test. All you have to write is fixtures files. And the idea is you have to comment, a code comment above the line you want to resolve. So in this case, we have the require FS call. And the comment above says, okay, this FS needs to link to the Node.js website. And the same works for relative files. And because it's just a code comment, it also works for other languages. And it works even in JSON. Note that this double slash key value is officially supported by npm to embed comments in your package JSON, and we make use of this fact. So we end up with a fixtures file folder structure like this. There are way more files in the actual repo, but you get a sense. So you have different languages, different tools with fixtures files with those annotations. And then before running the test, we walk through this fixtures folder and generate a fixtures JSON file, which looks like this. So every fixture, every annotation in those fixture files is becoming an object like this, where the URL is just the URL to this fixture file, the line comment, the line number, and the target URL. And then it's fairly simple at the actual end-to-end test, which just goes through all the fixtures, opens the URL in the browser, and then it waits for the given URL on the given number line number, and that's it. And as I said, you don't have to write stuff like this. All you have to write is just the fixture files with the annotation, and that's it. And this is the reason why we ended up with 143 end-to-end tests in Octolinker, which is quite a lot compared to integration tests. And again, the unit test is a vast amount because of the regular expression tests that we have. On the API surface, we have 24 end-to-end tests and a few unit tests. Most of you maybe are familiar with the testing pyramid. There's another concept which I really like from KenCidot. This is the testing trophy, where you have a base with static tests like ESLint, and then above the unit test, and the fast amount should be your integration test. And then on top, you have the end-to-end test. But if you compare it with Octolinker, you see it's quite balanced, the integration test and the end-to-end test. And in the Octolinker case, it's so simple because all Octolinker does is resolving HTML source code or make source code clickable. So there is, so there's only, it's only, it does one thing, and therefore end-to-end tests are really suitable for this type of scenario. This is everything about testing Octolinker. There's a second talk by me about Postgresbatch, but we can now take questions regarding Octolinker.
You listed out all the different technologies that you support with Octolinker. Have you considered adding support for something like Webpack aliases and things like that? So it actually calls out to the Webpack API.
Yeah, that's actually a long time requested feature, and it wasn't possible to do this because of the way how Octolinker works. But when was the last big refactoring? It was maybe a year ago, 1.5 years ago. So now this is in theory possible, but I didn't have time to actually tackle this, and also no personal need, to be honest. But in theory, it's possible because in order to resolve such things, you need to make a call. You need to first call this Webpack config file in order then to resolve the actual file. And this was literally not possible. But now it's in theory possible, but it's not implemented currently.
Okay. Pull requests accepted?
For sure.
Well, on that note, would you say that this, you seem to have gone to great lengths to make it easy to contribute tests, particularly unit tests and end-to-end tests. Would you say that your testing strategy has encouraged people to contribute to this project?
Yeah, no one contributes end-to-end tests just because he is funny or he wants to. But it's actually working really well. So there's currently an issue open with Python that it's not that well, the support, because I'm not a Python developer. So I just interpret how the module loading should work in Python, and it's more or less correct, but it's missing a few cases. And so I just pointed him to the documentation about end-to-end tests and how to contribute them. And a few days later, he raised a PR with a lot of test cases. And now it's so easy for me just to make those test cases work.
Mm. Oh, okay, excellent. That's really cool. And lastly, just a quick question about the way that you said they resolves the dependency. So it calls out to the Octolinker API and that proxies on to, say, the NPM API or whatever. Let's say you've got a package.json with 40 dependencies in there. Does that mean that you're making 40 individual requests to the Octolinker API?
No. No, there's a bulk endpoint, basically, where you can send multiple packages through that you need to resolve.
And will they? Is there a bulk endpoint on the NPM side as well, or do you just?
No, I just hit it.
Yeah,
but as I said, there's a caching wall which caches all the dependencies for quite some time. I don't remember if it's a day or 3 days. I never get any complaints from NPM, so it should be fine.
Okay, brilliant stuff. And hi, Andy, by the way.
Welcome to the second part of my talk, which is about Postgresbatch. It's a GitHub app that I wrote 2 years ago. It originally started as a bash script, and because at Brandwatch, we add a link to the related GR ticket to the PR description. And I was just annoyed doing this manually. And because we already have this convention that we prefix the branch name with the ticket number, I wrote a bash script, which is basically picking up that and generates the URL for me. And because it's generating the HTML markdown for me, I was also able to make this pretty by using a batch service. And this is how it started. And today it's a GitHub app, which is essentially still the same. But the benefit is that people don't have to have this bash script locally on their machine, and it just works out of the box if people follow on this pattern by either prefixing the branch or the PR title with the GR prefix. Oh, here's the demo. Sorry. Always miss the demo. So here we see just a random repo of mine. There is Postgresbatch installed. Let's make just a simple change. and we want to raise a PR. Oh. So now when we create the PR, the GitHub API, the Octolink API, sorry, not Octolink, the Polygos GitHub app is called, and then it inserts this batch. Oh, I actually, I missed the Jira prefix, sorry. So this is the reason why it only shows the PR size batch and not the Jira batch. So let's open another PR. I will just put two. We need to create a new branch. And then in the title, we go on IBC123. Hello. And now if we reload, we get two batches. And this batch is linking, as you may see on the bottom left, to a Jira URL. And yeah, that's the basic idea of Octolinker. Polygos batch. I should never do two talks in a meetup. I just need to rearrange my window. So here. A GitHub app, you need to configure often using a special file in your .github folder. And this is how it looks like, the config for a Jira batch. It's quite self-explanatory. Then there's the same for the PR size. You can also do conditions as we saw earlier, because the Jira batch was missing because there was no prefix, but you can also do conditions on other things like addition of lines and author name, labels, basically anything. And how does this work? So when you create a new pull request, webhook is made to the pull request batch GitHub app. This is then calling GitHub and reading the config from the repo. And this is the only file that this GitHub app has access to. And then it updates the PR description with the batches based on the config from the from this config file. There's only one test suite for pull request batch, which is there to ensure extracting the Jira prefix from either the PR title or branch name is working. And that's it. Everything else is end-to-end tested. This is how our end-to-end test looks like. So you have to provide a config, so similar to this .github config file in your repo. And then as a second argument, you will need to provide the webhook payload. And there's a standard one that I have in the repo, basically. But in case you need to override certain values, for example, if you want to check conditions, you can extend this standard payload with additional values or override them in this case. This is a recording of me running the end-to-end tests. It's real time, so it's sometimes a bit slow because it calls the GitHub APIs and this may takes a while. So this is one disadvantage of end-to-end tests. They are slow, but this is by nature just the case for all end-to-end tests. But as you can see, it now goes to all the test cases and creates a config file, or it updates the PR description, and based on the config, it either adds one batch or two batches with different conditions. And in total, it takes, I think, 2 minutes to run, or maybe a little bit less, but you get the idea. So yeah, I will show you how this works. So the pull request batch is a robot app, which is a framework that helps you to build GitHub apps much easier. And it comes with a CLI. And the CLI is really useful for local development. So just imagine if you want to create pull request batch, you don't want to create 10 PRs just to test your code. So this is where the CLI comes in handy, where you can basically replay a webhook event from GitHub. So you store the webhook on disk as a file, and then you can replay this. And this is what I basically do when testing the pull-request batch app. So we replay the new pull-request event, and this calls then the app, which is runs locally in this case. And there's one difference. It does read the config not from the config file in the repo. It reads the config from the PR description. So the config is part of the PR description. Why I'm doing this? Mainly to make my life easier, because otherwise I need to make another call to the to this config file. I need to update this config file. Then I need to wait until this is done. And then I need to raise the PR or replay this event. And by making this part of the pull request description, it's basically just one operation, and therefore it's much easier. And also, as you have seen, it's also quite nice for debugging purposes. So if the end-to-end tests run, I also see the configs which are currently in place to render the different batches. And once this is done, then it works like before. It updates the description on GitHub, and then there is a second request made via the GitHub API to get the description from GitHub, and then again just snapshots to compare if the description on this PR is the same as expected. I also wrote a REPL, which is super handy even for myself to just try out new configs, because as I said, running end-to-end tests is slow. And one disadvantage of the current of this approach that I have currently is that you have to run all the tests all the time, because you don't have expect blocks. So again, similar to Octolinker, I walk through a folder and just generate the test at runtime, so to say. And the disadvantage here is, as I said, you cannot run one particular, or not that easy. And so therefore, the REPL is quite handy, and it also gives you a few other use cases, what you could do with the batches. And yeah, again, here we have 40 end-to-end tests and 31 unit tests, which again is mainly, or is only exclusively testing to extract the Jira prefix from a string. And that's everything about testing pull request batch. Thanks for having me. I hope this was useful.